Thank you, choir and orchestra. I don't know about you, but it is good to see some sunshine. Praise the Lord. Get up on Sunday morning and it is not raining outside. Sunshine and a little bit of warm weather. Man, that is what the doctor ordered for today. God's given us a beautiful day that we can come together and worship Him. I want you to open your Bibles once again back to the book of Deuteronomy. Find chapter 5, and in a moment we're going to be focusing on one very powerful verse in Deuteronomy chapter 5. That is verse number 11. You know, forgery is the unauthorized use of someone else's name. It is a signing of a document that is unapproved. It is taking a name and it's misusing that name. I remember several years ago that someone stole my credit card information, and they purchased a lot of items using my name, and they were not authorized to do so. Now, finally, eventually, I got my money back, but I tell you, it was a hassle as that was occurring. Now, as we continue our series today in which we are looking at the hope for America, which is the home, we are taking God's Ten Commandments, we are applying them to the home, to the family, to fix the family, and the result of that is we will end up fixing a nation. And I want to look at something today that's a real burden on my heart, that I really feel like it's something that we desperately as parents need to instruct our children about while they are under our tutelage. And that's the proper use of God's name. And I say that because our kids are growing up in a culture where the misuse of God's name has reached epidemic proportions. It is not only in the secular world, but it is in the religious world as well. And that's what I want to talk about today. Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse number 11, where the Lord says, "You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. For the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain." Now, I don't know about you, but it seems like God's quite serious about this, because he says that anybody that takes God's name in vain, that misuses God's name, they will not be held guiltless. I mean, what is all this fuss anyway about a name? I think sometimes that we fail to think about the far-reaching implications of a name. And when we're talking about a name, at its most basic function, a name symbolizes a person. And so to use that name in the wrong way is offensive to the person that the name is symbolizing. And the way that we use God's name tells us something about the way that we think about God, what we know about God, how we value Him. I mean, you just think about some of the implications of a name and what that name means. I would say, first of all, that a name implies character. It implies character. You know, if I were to mention to you the name Benedict Arnold, or the name Judas Iscariot, or the name Osama bin Laden, immediately these negative images would come to your mind because you would think about the character that those names represented. Or if I were to change that up and I were to mention the name George Washington or the name Abraham Lincoln, then you would have positive images that would come to your mind because of the character of those names that I just mentioned. Names are important. Names are so important until the writer of Proverbs said in Proverbs 22 and verse number 1, love this verse, I have it in a frame in my home, and it says that a good name is rather to be chosen than great riches. God thinks a lot about a name. And when we use God's name in a way that does not reflect His true character, then that is offensive to God. And when we misuse God's name in our home, in front of our children, we are helping them to develop unhealthy perceptions of who God really is. So name implies character. Name also implies authority. I remember when my children were small and when I wanted the older brothers to listen to their younger sister, I would tell Casey, "Now you tell your brothers that this is what Dad said." There was authority in that name. And when you and I come to the Lord God and we come to Him in prayer and we use the name of Jesus, we pray in Jesus' name, to pray like that is to pray in such a way where we are using the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ in appealing to the Heavenly Father. It also implies that we are living underneath His lordship and His authority, that we are asking something that Jesus would ask if Jesus were making that request. And so trying to manipulate God by misusing Jesus' name is to take God's name in vain. It would be just like Casey, and she would take my name and that authority and misuse that name in order to try to get something out of her brothers. It is the same principle when we misuse the name of Jesus when we are praying to the Heavenly Father. But I think also that a name implies a relationship. You know, if I were in a crowded room and someone said, Craig, I would just assume that it was someone who knew me, that I had a relationship with. And so to use God's name when we don't have a relationship with the Father, then what is that doing? That is using His name in vain. Now, what I want to do is I want to take this idea of misusing God's name. I want to look at it in three different ways. One of the ways you'll be very familiar with, but I'll bet the other two, so you hold on until we get there, I'll bet that you have not thought about that at all when it comes to taking God's name in vain. So first of all, I want to talk about the obvious misuse of God's name. Did you know, friend, that God's name is profoundly sacred? In Psalm 8, verse 1, the Bible says, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic or excellent is your name. Psalm 119, verse 9 says, Holy and reverent is God's name. The Orthodox Jews, they thought about the name of God as being a name that was extremely sacred. When they came to that name in translating of the scriptures and transcribing them, and they came to that personal name for God, that redemptive name for God, that covenant name for God, which was the name Yahweh, they would come to that name Yahweh, they would put their pen down, they would get up, they would go take a bath, they would put on a fresh suit of clothes, take up a pen that had never been used before they would even write the name of God. That is how sacred that the Orthodox Jews considered the name of God to be. And dear friend, you realize that when we misuse God's name, when we take it in vain, we are trampling on the holy, sacred, precious name of God. There's nobody in this building today that would throw their Bibles on the floor and just trample on them and walk on them. Yet when we misuse the name of God and when we take it in vain, we are trampling on the holy, sacred name of God. Well, how in the world, what are some of these obvious misuses of God's name? Number one is there's profanity. Profanity. I don't know about you, but I learned that when I got saved, I lost about half of my vocabulary. Because when Jesus cleaned up my heart, He also cleaned up my mouth. Now, what are we talking about when we talk about profanity? We're talking about cursing. We're talking about swearing. We're talking about taking the word damn and using it as if it is God's last name. That is profanity. And friends, our children are growing up and they're living in a filthy, vulgar, rotten talking culture. And it's up to you and I to teach our kids what is acceptable language and what is not acceptable language. It seems like some people, when they use profanity, they think that it's an indication of their intelligence. In reality, it reveals their ignorance, that they have a very limited vocabulary. Their vocabulary is so limited that they have to reach down in the gutter and pick up a word to complete a sentence. I'm amazed today at the numbers of university graduates that have such a limited vocabulary, that they have to fill that vocabulary with profanity. You know what profanity does? It reveals the condition of one's heart. Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Dirty words, dirty heart. Filthy words, filthy heart. Vile words, vile heart. Vulgar words, vulgar heart. Profane words, profane heart. Profanity reveals the condition of one's heart. I think that the mouth also reveals the character of an individual. You know, oftentimes someone will say, oh, preacher, I just cuss a little. You know, that's like saying, well, I just commit adultery a little. I just steal a little. I just murder a little. I hadn't killed but two people in the last 10 years. You know, friend, if your language is filled with profanity, I'm telling you, it's proof that you're a lawbreaker and you need a Savior. That's what these Ten Commandments do. They reveal to us how far short that we fall of the glory of God. But it says a lot about our character. Socrates used to say, when meeting someone for the first time, speak so that I can see you. Speak so that I can see you. The words that we use, the language that we use, it reveals the character of who we are. And I want to tell you, moms and dads, that the first notice that your children are using bad language and they have dirty mouths, that's the time to correct them. Well, my grandmother did. I was raised in a sheltered environment, a little old bitty community, and just basically all my kin folks lived around me. And I didn't hear a lot of dirty words in my house. And when I went to the first grade, we didn't have kindergarten back there. We just had grades 1 through 12 at Hilliard School. And I went to the first grade, and the first day in the first grade out on the playground, I learned a word I'd never heard before. And I was so proud of myself. I went home and shared that word with my grandmother. She wasn't impressed. She grabbed me by the collar, drug me into the bathroom, and shoved a bar of Dove soap down my throat. That's the truth. I'm not just preaching. She actually washed my mouth out with soap. I blew bubbles for the next 3 weeks. But I never used that word again for the rest of my life. Parents, teach your kids what's acceptable language and what is not. When vulgar language comes out of their mouth, correct them. And so how do we abuse God's name? By profanity. Secondly, by frivolity. That word vain means empty or useless. It's to take something serious and treat it lightly. To take God's name in vain is to take God's name and separate it from its intended use and using it in a way that God never intended. When Jesus taught us to pray in the Lord's Prayer, He said, we are to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Taking God's name in vain is using it in a flippant way, in an irreverent way. Jesus Christ, you've just used God's name in vain. Oh my God, just used God's name in vain. To treat lightly those things that are associated with God's name is to take God's name in vain. God's word, God's house, God's people, God's day, whatever is associated with God, to treat that lightly and irreverently is to take God's name in vain. So we abuse it with profanity and frivolity, but also hypocrisy. What is hypocrisy? Hypocrisy is giving lip service to our faith without giving life service to our faith. Isaiah chapter 48, verse 1 speaks of this. Hear this, O house of Jacob, who are called by the name of Israel, and have come forth from the wellsprings of Judah, who swear by the name of the Lord, and make mention of the God of Israel. In other words, His name is on their lips, but not in truth or righteousness. Jeremiah chapter 12 and verse number 2. You have planted them. Yes, they have taken root. They grow. Yes, they bear fruit. You are near in their mouth, but you are far from their mind. That is to pay heed to lip service, but not life service to our faith. You know, we can play the hypocrite in three ways in our profession. When we profess to know Jesus as our Savior, but we are not living for Him as our Lord, then we are taking God's name in vain. We can do it in our prayers. We simply rattle off a prayer, but we are not thinking about what we are praying or to whom we are praying. We take God's name in vain. Jesus said something about prayer over in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, when He said, "But you, when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in the secret place, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. When you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you even ask Him." We don't say prayers, we pray prayers. And for me to get up behind this pulpit this morning and do our offertory prayer and not even think about what I'm praying or the one to whom I am praying and just rattle off some words, that's taking God's name in vain. We can do it in our profession. We can do it in our prayers. We can do it in our praise. Friend, I want to tell you to sing about God and to sing to God while our minds are simply gathering dust is to take His name in vain. In other words, if I stand and I sing that great old hymn, "My Jesus, I love Thee, I know Thou art mine. For Thee all the follies of sin I resign. But I've not thought for years about repenting. I've just taken God's name in vain." See, that's the obvious misuses of God's name. And I secondly here, by the grace of God, if He'll help me, man, I want to hammer down here the religious misuse of God's name. How do we misuse God's name religiously? Parents, I want to tell you, there is an enemy that will sneak into the hearts of your kids and will steal your children. You know what it is? It's the thief of religion. The thief of religion will just suck the life out of them. The thief of religion, listen, it'll suck them into a cultish, false religion, or into a false doctrine. And we've got to somehow see the earnestness and the seriousness of rising up in Jesus' name and teaching our children how to differentiate the true from the false in the religious world. Because there is so much today in the stinking religious world that is false, and it's grabbing our kids by the neck and it's choking the life out of them. Friend, just because something is identified as being religious, it does not mean it is of God. It does not mean it's right. It does not mean that it is true. And I want to tell you, one of the ugliest realities of the history of faith is that there has always been people who have used their religion as a means of getting ahead. As long as godly men and women have sought to serve God from a pure and a righteous heart, there have been those who have sought to use their spiritual position and the hungry spiritual hearts of others to line their own pockets. P.T. Barnum once said, "There is a sucker born every minute." End of quote. There's a sucker born every minute. And friend, the church has no shortage of men and women ready to put on a show to relieve people that are short on discernment of their extra pocket change. And we've got to help our kids know how to distinguish between the two. You see, our children have got to be taught to distinguish between those that are real, those that are genuinely being used by God, and those who are simply users of God's name. Cult leaders prey on the unsuspecting young who do not have the ability to discern and spot the phonies that are out there. I have been in the ministry a long time, and I'm telling you, I've never seen more phonies in the ministry than I'm seeing today. And our kids have got to be well equipped and educated how they can spot them. Friend, just because someone names the name of God and does dramatic supernatural things does not mean that that person is of God and is being used by God. And even mature people can be led astray by all of these religious charlatans that are populating the religious landscape of our day. Thought about whether I ought to do this or not, and I think I need to. I want you to open your Bibles with me to Acts chapter 8. You can hold your place in Deuteronomy if you want to, but I want you to go to Acts chapter 8. I want to read a lengthy passage of Scripture. You can follow along with me, because here in Acts chapter 8, we see how to differentiate between the one that is being used by God and the one who is simply a user of God's name. So look in Acts chapter 8, beginning with verse number 4. Acts chapter 8, verse number 4. Therefore, those who were scattered, they went everywhere preaching the word. Then Philip, he went down to the city of Samaria, and he preached Christ to them. And the multitudes, with one accord, they heeded the things spoken by Philip, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits, crying with a loud voice, they came out of many who were possessed, many who were paralyzed, the lame were healed, and there was great joy in that city. Number one, here is a guy that was used by God. But after that, we are immediately introduced to someone that was simply a user of God's name. Verse 9, but there was a certain man that was called Simon, who previously practiced sorcery in the city and astonished the people of Samaria, claiming that he was someone great, to whom they all gave heed, from the least to the greatest, saying, this man is the great power of God. And they heeded him because he had astonished them with his sorceries for a long time. So he was in a religious racket business for a long time before Philip even showed up. Verse 12, but when they believed Philip as he preached the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, both men and women were baptized. Then Simon himself also believed. Did he really? And when he was baptized, he continued with Philip and was amazed seeing the miracles and the signs which were done. Now, scholars have debated over the years whether or not Simon genuinely was born again. I say he was not, and I'll show you why. Verse 14, now when the apostles who were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them, who when they had come down, they prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For as yet he had fallen upon none of them. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. And when Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands the Holy Spirit was given, he offered them money, saying, give me this power also, that anyone on whom I lay hands may receive the Spirit. Why did he want to do that? He wanted to do that for his own prophet. Verse number 20, but Peter said to him, your money perish with you, because you thought that the gift of God could be purchased with money. You have neither part nor portion in this matter, for your heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent therefore of this your wickedness and pray God. Now, if he'd just gotten saved, why in the world would he need to repent of this wickedness? And so verse 23, for I see that you are poisoned by bitterness and you are bound by iniquity. Then Simon answered and said, "Pray to the Lord for me that none of these things which you have spoken, that they may come upon me." Here is the classic example of someone who was simply a user of God's name rather than someone that was being used by God. Now, friend, here is the key. Parents, write these things down. I'm telling you, they will help you teach your children how to spot the phonies out there. Number one is the motive. The motive. What was Simon's motive? Get rich. Get rich. There is no shortage of those kinds of people still in spiritual leadership positions who simply want to use God and His name to get rich. In other words, when they see the word ministry, what they really see is dollar signs. This is a way for me to pad my pocket. Now, friend, for the life of me, I can't understand one of the most popular people in the Christian world today. I can't understand how anybody could follow someone like Kenneth Copeland as he boards his private jet to fly around the world to, quote, minister to the people. I don't get it. Now, don't misunderstand me. Every true servant of God that serves the Lord should be compensated well for their service. Paul said that the laborer is worthy of his hire. And yet no pastor, including this pastor, ought to ever just live in the lap of excessive luxury while the one that he says to follow didn't even have a place to lay his head. I want to tell you the telltale sign of someone who is in it just to use God's name. It's always the money. Follow the money. What is the motive? Is it ministry? Is it people? Is it the changing of lives? Is it the salvation of souls? Or is it simply the money? So number one, the motive. Second way you can spot them according to this text is the attention. Friend, I want to tell you the real sign that a work is an authentic work of God is what is the focus of that work. Look down in verse number 5 of Acts chapter 8. What was Philip's focus? Well, in verse number 5, he tells us. Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria. And what did he do? He preached Christ to them. That was the focus of his ministry. Preached Christ. He preached the gospel. What was the focus of Simon's ministry? Verse 9. But there was a certain man called Simon, who previously practiced sorcery in the city, astonished the people of Samaria, claiming that he was someone great. Men of God don't claim to be great. John the Baptist said, "He must increase, I must decrease." Now you listen very carefully. Dear friend, when the focus of a ministry is anything other than God and God's Christ, you better watch out. When the focus is a man, or the focus is a woman, or the focus is a ministry, or the focus is an experience, or the focus is a miracle, or the focus is even one singular doctrine that has been pulled out from every other doctrine to explain the attributes of God, you better watch out. Because there's a good chance, a good possibility, that's not the real deal. Friend, I want to tell you what, when you are in the middle of the real deal, you are attracted to Christ, to Christ, to Christ, to Christ, to the gospel, to the cross. If you're attracted to any other thing, you better run, because it's not of God. So we have the motive, we have the audience, but we also have the people. What happened to the people in Philip's ministry, which was the real deal? Verse 7 says, "For unclean spirits, crying with a loud voice, came out of many who were possessed, and many who were paralyzed, and the lame were healed, and there was great joy in the city." Here is the people. They were set free. Set free. When you are in the middle of a ministry that's the real deal, Satan is going to lose his grip on people, and they're going to be set free. Did you notice the Bible said in that verse that there was great freedom and there was great joy? But you see, oftentimes, in a ministry that is not the real deal, what happens is that people are bound up. They are bound up in legalism. They are bound up in a relationship, an authoritarian relationship with a pastor. I want to tell you, I've known pastors, plenty of them, who were just authoritarians that just walked throughout the church like they were little Lord Ha-Has, and everybody had to bow down to everything that they said. That's an authoritarian relationship that is not healthy. And anytime that is spotted, people need to run from it. But then the third thing, or fourth thing, is the people, the attention, the motive, the people. Fourth thing is the method. Now, when we read this story, are you listening? Say amen. Amen. We see that many, many times the users are preoccupied with the spectacle. They are always loving, but they always speak the truth in love. And they will never change the message just to have a following. And when we have well-known leaders in the Christian world that get on television and are doing interviews with people and are asked questions like, is Jesus the only way? And realizing that the answer to that is, yes, He is. Or ask the question, is homosexuality a sin? And then just completely bypass that and not answer. Don't you tell me that there are not those out there today that change the message. Why do they do that? It is because they don't want to offend anybody. Because if they offend somebody, then their pockets are going to be stopped being lined with their money. Apparently, some of you looking at me like a calf looking at a new gate, but I'm telling you, you better wise up and teach your children these things. But there's a third thing very quickly, and that is the subtle misuse of God's name. You see, not everyone that's a user, not everyone that has this user mentality toward God, not everyone goes out and starts a religious movement or proclaims himself as being a spiritual teacher. But I want to tell you, there is a much more subtle thing at work, and I don't think that we're even aware of this. And that is, the temptation is to develop a consumer mentality toward God. That's to misuse God's name. What can God do for me? What can the church do for me? Me, 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 me. That's a consumer mentality, and it misuses God's name. I want to ask us two questions. And the answer to these two questions will determine whether or not we have developed a consumer mentality. First question, what is the major focus of my life? What is the major, the primary, the number one focus of my life? And if anything or anyone has replaced God as the focus of our life, then we will use everything else and anyone else, including God, to meet the goals of what has become the center of our life. So everything else just becomes subservient to what it is that I've placed at the center of my life, in meeting my needs and taking care of my wants. And so all of a sudden, God then becomes a resource in helping me accomplish those goals. For example, it could be a Christian businessman or a Christian businesswoman, and they just say, hey man, Using God's name to advertise, boy, that's good for business. And so the name of God just becomes an advertising gimmick for our business. I had a man years ago get mad with me in our church and even left our church because he wanted to put together a directory of Christian businesses in our church and then hand those out to the people so that the people would do their business with a Christian business. And I thought, you know, I understand your motive. That's a good deal, but I'm not going to let you do that. And the reason being is I don't want somebody going to a, quote, Christian business, and they may not even be Christians. And they rip somebody off. And all of a sudden, the testimony of Jesus is harmed. Friend, we don't use God to profit us. God uses us to bring Him glory. And when we seek to use the name of God in a way that brings personal profit to us, that is to separate that name from God's intended use. And that is taking God's name in vain. What is the major focus of my life? And I close with this. What is the major response of my life? What's the major response of my life? In other words, when things don't go my way, when circumstances run counter to my expectations, what is my response? Do I get angry or do I praise God? Do I see God as the one who is sovereign, who has the right to interfere with my plans? And when He uses my circumstances that run counter to my expectations and it doesn't turn out the way that I want it to turn out, how do I respond? If I've developed a consumer mentality, I just get angry with those circumstances. Friends, God is not a genie in a bottle that we just rub a certain way to get anything that we want. He is the Lord God of the universe who sits on the throne of the entire world. That's who He is. And He's always good and He's always kind and He's always gracious and always loving and always forgiving and always holy and always right and always knows what's best. That's God. So do we worship Him? Do we praise Him? Or do we simply get angry when things do not go our way? You know what the most amazing thing is to me? This incredible God that I've just described, He desires to serve us. Mark 10:45, Jesus said, "I've not come to be served, but I've come to serve and to give my life a ransom for many." But just because He's good and He's kind and He's gracious and He wants to meet every need in our life, every need, we don't have a right to treat Him like a servant. God doesn't have to give us what we want. He is not required to do that. You know, businesses trademark their names. And when they trademark their names, they have taken legal action whereby they are the owner of that name. And the only way that anyone or any other business can use that name is to have a license to do so. God has licensed us to use His name with one restriction: don't take it in vain. Because to take it in vain, God said, "I'll not hold anyone guiltless who does." The best way anyone could ever take God's name is to take it for salvation. Because in Romans 10, verse 13, the Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Have you called upon the name of the Lord for salvation? Have you taken it like that? How are we using God's name today? And how are we teaching our children to use it? Would you stand, please? And heads are bowed and eyes are closed.